I'm not going to lie to anybody listening to this podcast right now.
Yeah.
I've got a producer in my ear singing the theme music because we lost ours. Mark Adelberg, what up? Giving
Mark
me the right energy coming into the show.
It's a very soothing, pleasing tone in my right ear, Mark Adelberg.
Yeah, he's got a good voice.
It's very pleasing to my ear.
Yeah, like we might just ditch the track altogether, Mark, and just have Adelberg.
Mark, we can put you to good use in other areas of the production of this hockey and baseball,
yes,
at this network.
We multi-talented
can
Mark
Adelberg. We can put
you
to use in other areas.
Yes, but hello, everybody.
Come see me. We're going to take your career to a whole nother level.
Welcome to Puck Culture, everybody. We're off to a roaring start. Jackie Redmond alongside Stu Grimson. Mm-hmm. Happy to be back. No podcast last week. I was on the edge of I don't know what, but I was very
You're
ill.
You're back from the grave.
I'm
You're
back from the grave.
Basically back from the grave.
1 foot in, for
You were running 104 degrees.
I was.
I reached out to you. I was getting these faint, can a text be faint? They seem to faint.
Nice.
You seem faint on the other end.
I'll tell you what I didn't have.
Oh,
a lot of energy. I was very sad. It was not a good week to be Jackie
all
Redmond.
All I can think of when I know people who are in that situation, like I think of my worst illnesses, and when you're sick with the flu or something like that, my impending feeling is always, this is it. I'm never going to get better again. This is now my life. I don't know what it's like to be healthy.
Well, this is what I was saying.
I hate that feeling, and I always feel so bad for people because I know you were in the throes of it. Oh. That's a long stretch of the flu you
Here's
had.
The thing. I never get the flu.
Yeah.
Like, I don't get the flu. When I get sick, I usually get a head cold or a cough or, you know, like a chest cold. Nope. This was full-fledged. Here's making up for, like, 15 years of not having the flu. Gonna get it all at once, but I'm back now, and I have a new mug, so I'm very excited about my mug.
What
do you want to read it for the people?
Say? It's been on the set for a while now. A day without coffee is like, just kidding. I have no idea.
Yeah, every day.
Let me know where you get that.
Every day.
I'm a bit of a sicko myself. We've been to,
with coffee.
Yeah,
I'll get you one. I'll hook you up.
Goofy,
I'll
my coffee addiction is.
All right.
I don't care to talk about it publicly in a public forum.
Okay. Well, you know what? I don't care to talk about it publicly in a public forum, but I have to. How bad the Toronto Maple Leafs are right now. I mean, we showed up both dressed in black. It's like it's a funeral today in Leafs Nation. People are upset.
It's the Leafs' wake.
Oh my gosh. So if you're listening in and you're not caught up, the Leafs lose to the Sabres 5-2 on Sunday. Yeah. Sheldon Keefe calls at the team, says this is the worst we've looked in a very long time. Then they go out against Pittsburgh, drop 2-0 to start the game. During the intermission, Sheldon Keefe reportedly tears a strip off the team, says everything he can say to the team to try to motivate them. They go out 5-0 Pittsburgh. Yeah. It ends up being just an embarrassing performance against the Penguins. Fire Dubas was trending. Kyle Dubas is the general manager.
Yeah.
Should Leafs Nation be as panicked as they are, in your opinion?
There's good reason to be panicked, without question. I mean, look at how precariously this team is positioned right now. They're clinging to the third playoff spot, the third spot in the Atlantic Division. But Florida has two games at hand, Jackie. Florida is 2 points back. And if the Leafs, if the Panthers catch the Leafs, they don't just fall to wild card one or wild card two. They plummet right through both wild card spots to fourth. They're two back of a wild card spot. So there's a lot to be concerned about. Add to that, I was watching the broadcast last night. I think it was, did NBC cover last night's Pittsburgh-Toronto game?
Yes.
Or did I watch the Pittsburgh broadcast?
No, correct.
Broadcast?
It was.
Yeah, and they flashed something I thought was even more daunting. They rolled out the Leafs' next five games. And I think all but one club are all playoff position or, you know, first, second in their respective divisions. They've got a tough next stretch of five games. So Dubas is in a really, you know, tough spot. Am I a buyer? Am I a seller? What do I do with this team? I thought I had the makings of something that was pretty special here, but we're seeing something very, very different out of this group.
What's alarming to me is the fact that not that they go out and they play Pittsburgh and they lose in the way that which they did. Pittsburgh is a really good team.
Yeah.
What's most alarming to me is that it comes on the heels of the Sabres game. So two games in a row now, you've seen a team basically appear to lay an egg.
Yeah.
And the effort didn't appear to be there. The passion, the fight, that intangible vibe that you get from a team that's hungry to win. The Leafs did not have that last night.
I I agree with you, and I would say further, I don't think it's a one-part explanation. I think they lack jam. I think that goes back to the departing Nazem Kadri. I think they miss that Kadri-type player. I am with you on that 100%. My problems go more to a different sector of the lineup. We've all been lamenting for probably the better part of three years now. The Leafs aren't built that well on the back end. There are deficiencies there, and Dubas has failed to address this piece of it. It started with Muzzin. I liked that transaction last year. It was Cody Ceci in the offseason this year. But the
Tyson Barrie,
the changes he's made to attempt to impact the blue line, this team still, last night was a prime example. Sidney Crosby and the Penguins picked that team apart last night. It looked like men and boys. They still don't look good where the decor is considered. They still don't defend well. And we had this conversation today before we came on air. I put the skaters are more at fault in terms of the way it makes Freddie Anderson look bad. This is an elite level goaltender in our game. It's not a Freddie issue. It's not a goaltending issue necessarily. To me, it goes more to the skaters and their inability to defend well.
Yeah, I'll address both the things that you just brought up, and I'll start with the defensive issues, which has been an issue for the Toronto Maple Leafs, as you mentioned, for more than just this season. Yeah. And I'm starting to notice a trend. A lot of the Leafs forwards are similar-ish type players. A lot of the Leafs defensemen are similar-ish type players, offensive defensemen. And then what do I see last night after the game is that there's reports that the Leafs' interest in Matt Dumba has escalated. Matt Dumba's a good hockey player. Yeah. I get it. But he's also a small offensive defenseman, yeah, which isn't necessarily what the Toronto Maple Leafs need. They need depth on the blue line for sure, especially yeah, because Riley and Muzzin are hurt, but they need a different type of defenseman back yeah, there as well. So that's the first part. The second part, and this just makes me mad. Honestly, I was a little fired up last night watching this. Do we have a fired up sound effect that we can play right here?
Well, if you're going to cuss, we're going to bleep you.
Well, I'm not going to swear.
Introduce.
That I will not do because I won't be back
but
on the podcast
that,
if I do that.
But you're that kind of angry.
I'm just, you know what, I don't, and it's just the nature of the sport. The goaltenders always take a huge portion of the blame when a team is losing.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's warranted, other times it is not. Has Frederik Andersen been a Vezina-caliber goaltender this year? Hard no. Capital N, no, he has not. Is he the sole reason the Leafs are losing? Absolutely not. I mean, listen, since January 1st, they have a 5-on-5 save percentage as a team of 902. That's good for second worst in the NHL. Anderson himself, 886 save percentage since January 1st, which is worse in the league. And when you focus just on that number, it's easy to go, Anderson needs to be better. Anderson needs to be better. But when you watch the games and you see the position that this team is putting Freddie Anderson in night after night yeah, after night, eventually something's going to give, and the other team, especially a team of the Pens caliber, they're yeah, going to pot some goals when you're leaving yeah, guys wide open in front of the net and letting Sidney Crosby basically have his way with your team in the offensive zone. It's not going to go well. It's not Frederik Andersen's fault. This team doesn't play defense.
The Leafs are 27th in terms of goals allowed by a single club this year. That's abysmal for the way that team is built right now. They are number one, I believe, in terms of high danger chances against.
That's not surprising.
That's not an Anderson.
If you watch the games.
That's not a Freddie Anderson issue. But I think the lesson that Dubas, I think the lesson the Leafs, or the way to address the Leafs problem, in addition to the jam, the sandpaper issue we talked about, was look at the way some of these really successful teams are built, or teams that are having success are built. If the Blues taught us anything last year, yes, the trend today is towards a smaller, faster player, but in terms of the way blue lines are built, the Colton Parekos, the Jay Bomeisters, I like a Tyler Myers out in Vancouver. Matthias Ekholm is a bigger defender, but covers, he's very agile and very hard to play against. Those guys, to me, yes, they have some offensive upside, but the way they defend, I mean, that's an anchoring, centering, stabilizing force within your roster if you've got guys like that that can play that way.
Yeah, offense is never going to be an issue for the Toronto Maple Leafs. We all know that. But you can't really win anything if your team is not dialed in defensively. And it doesn't just fall on the defenseman either. It's the forward's job, too, to play a better 200-foot game to sort of do something other than score. And it just seems like this team, when the stacks are chipped against, when the chips are stacked against them, I almost messed that up really bad.
Yeah.
No, not almost. I did. Anyways, moving right along, it seems like they don't deal with adversity well. When they're losing a game, when pressure's on, when they've had a tough week, the Leafs don't seem to bounce back or respond well to that.
Yeah, and they're a little fragile. They're a little delicate.
Here's
and
the thing.
Quicker to chase a game than a lot of teams.
It's not that the Leafs are losing. It's how the Leafs are losing. And when you look at the words that are coming out of the players and the coaching staff around that team, what have we heard? So Mike Babcock gets fired. Sheldon Keefe comes in. Yay, Sheldon Keefe. He's a nicer coach. Within the first month of coaching there, I believe, he calls the team immature. Mm-hmm. Says they were an immature team out in Florida. Then Jake Muzzin, a couple of weeks ago, guy that's won a Stanley Cup, knows what a winning culture looks like, knows the effort and the work that it takes to win a Stanley Cup, talks about how the Leafs sometimes rely too much on their skill to win games and that you need more than that. He says that. Then last night, we hear players talking about a lack of passion. The love of the game just doesn't seem to be there sometimes. Forget about not having enough depth on defense. That's a little more concerning. Those types of comments coming out of the room over and over and over again. You can be upset after a loss and the room can be quiet. But when your head coach comes in during an intermission and tries to ignite you by throwing everything he can at you, calls you out publicly, now the players are talking about your lack of emotion.
Yeah.
There's something wrong with the culture of that team right now, if you ask me. It's not, the way the team is currently constructed is just not good enough to win anything substantial.
One area to start, and really I think the final point I'll make on this is you need to look at an area of strength, which is the forward core. They've got some pretty dangerous skaters up front. Take somebody like a Kapanen, for instance, who is would be coveted by a lot of teams who struggle to score up front. Trade from an area of strength and deploy that person for, but here's the tricky part. I don't know who you go out and get now that somebody like, I really like Dylan.
Brendan Dillon.
I like somebody like a Dillon. I think he's a great
talk
defender.
About emotion.
Yeah.
What a passionate
really
human
like
being.
I really like a Brendan Dillon. But Brendan Dillon is no longer on the board. He's no longer a traded.
So a lot of defensemen no longer on the board.
Asset. I don't think somebody like Alec Martinez, who I'm hearing that is very available where the Kings are concerned. I don't know if that's the way to address the problem. To me, it's a couple of big rangy defenders.
And, you know, you mentioned Brendan Dillon. This is a deal that happened yesterday. The Washington Capitals acquired Brendan Dillon from the San Jose Sharks. And when it happened, I kind of instantly was like, why is it that these highly sought after, you know, trade targets or trade bait players, so often they get acquired by a team that doesn't necessarily need them? Like the Washington Capitals are a Stanley Cup contending team already.
Yeah.
And those good teams seem to get those players more often than the teams that are desperate for someone like that, like the Toronto Maple Leafs.
I felt that way too. I really did. So the minute that Dillon goes to Washington, I'm going, wow.
Great move for Washington.
It is. They're deeper. I get that. But I kind of like Washington's D before that ever happens. But I looked a little deeper at it, and it makes sense if you consider the following. Nick Jensen is up after this year, I believe. He's UFA going into the season. There's somebody that a handful of clubs out there, including the Leafs, depending on how they're processing all this, may be coveted. So perhaps McClelland in Washington is not yet finished just in terms of how he's kind of managing things as the deadline approaches. Perhaps Jensen's going out in exchange for somebody else. And you've done this kind of proactively, preemptively to bolster things. Because Dillon steps in, and he, to me, even the way Washington's built, he's the guy that's going to play top 4 minutes for them, I think.
And Jensen, actually, I believe, signed an extension with the Capitals. But I guess what stands out...
My mistake. He came off the board.
But the thing is... And here's a good way to compare it, too. if the Washington Capitals, who are having a pretty decent season, struggling the last week or so, but every team does at some point, the Washington Capitals having a great season, looking to contend for another Stanley Cup because the window for them is still right now. If they don't think they have enough depth on the blue line and are going out and getting a Brendan Dillon, how do you, as Kyle Dubas, possibly think that the Toronto Maple Leafs have enough depth on the blue line? You can't. If teams like that are going out and acquiring defensemen, teams like the Caps and the Blues and all of that, then safe to say you should probably be trying to do the same.
But here's the thing. I mean, again, I go back to the three transactions he's made in this area already. Muzzin, Barry, CeCe, these are significant established NHL players, guys that have played in a top four role elsewhere in the league. And yet, and I think perhaps, Jack, this goes back to your cultural problem, something is out of sync in terms of the way this group not so much is coached, but manages itself. I have concerns about the culture, given what I'm seeing.
Well, the Leafs have another date with the Pittsburgh Penguins on Thursday, so we'll see if they can bounce back this time. Because here, this is my whole thing. It's like these quotes come out after the game, and everybody's saying, but it's like... What's that phrase, when you cry wolf? It's like this team has been saying these things all season long, and they haven't really figured out how to fix it. So, I don't know.
It rings hollow after a while.
Yeah, exactly.
While,
but let's move on, because we could talk about the Leafs all day, but lots of deals.
15 minutes is a good solid block of time for a Leafs rant. I think that's a good that's a good amount of time.
Let's bring some other teams into the mix. We talk about Brendan Dillon going to the Capitals. That was one of many deals over the last few days in the NHL as we inch closer and closer to the trade deadline. The other, Tyler Toffoli going to the Vancouver Canucks, an important move because the Canucks, we learn, have lost Brock Besser for what's looking like 8 weeks. What do you think of Toffoli going to Van?
So that's one made out of necessity. And, you know, you think of what the Canucks gave up in exchange for Tyler Toffoli. And it's significant. Tyler Madden is projected to be perhaps a top two center in this league at some day. To me, that I appreciate that. It's not a given. He's undersized, so it could certainly go the other way. So, you know, I think further analysis required around all that. They give up Schala as well and then a pair of picks at the same time. To me, I think it makes great sense for the Canucks, given the way their season has gone. They've got a pretty good firm grip on one of the top three spots in the Pacific Division, and I think they bolster their chances and shore things up where Besser's, you know, future availability is somewhat in question going forward. So I like that. And to me, too, Toffoli is a guy, you know, not only does he bring, he's not that far removed from a 30-goal season, which I think relates back to 2016-17.
Yep.
This is a guy that could easily, given the cast of characters around him in Vancouver, he could rediscover that touch again and be very, very impactful. There's a lot to like up front where the Vancouver Canucks are concerned. And I think this does a lot for them just in terms of separating themselves from the rest of the Pacific field.
I like Jim Benning, too, yesterday in his press conference talking about how he believes this team can be a playoff team this year, and that's kind of what they're striving for. But when I look at this team, big picture, like not just this year, but the next couple of years, they just really feel like a team that is moving at a nice pace in the right direction.
Well, a transaction like this, too, remember the way that resonates inside that room for a group of guys like the Vancouver Canucks? Hey, our manager, our organization believes in us. We know Tyler Toffoli as well as anybody. He plays in our division. This is a guy that can really give us some bounce. And two, never mind just that impact. Going forward, like from a manager's point of view, Jackie, if you can make a transaction like this, I think you really help accelerate the development of what is a rather young Vancouver roster. Success breeds accelerated development. I think that's what Jim Benning's gone out and done. So I like that a lot for the Canucks. And listen, the other side of the ledger is Rob Blake and his his LA Kings. This is clearly a full-blown rebuild, and it's time to pivot some assets out and get some draft currency back in exchange.
And a little more Stanley Cup winning experience, too, in Tyler Toffoli joining the lineup
for
the Canucks.
Not altogether a bad thing.
Yeah, never a bad thing, especially on a really young team. All right, well, we're just a few days away from the deadline. Later in the show, I asked some people on Twitter for their wish lists, their desires for their teams. We're going to get to those in a little bit, but I want to touch on Alexander Ovechkin for a hot second because I was gone last week. I was out with the flu. Alexander Ovechkin chasing 700, right? 698. I'm supposed to fly to Washington last Sunday to cover the game and potentially this historic moment in NHL history. I come down with the flu and I'm like, oh my gosh.
I'm going to miss it.
Not just miss him do it, but to actually be present in that moment in the arena and be covering it. Yeah. I mean, what a highlight, right? So I was just devastated that I had to, you know, make the move or the decision. Exactly. So I'm so bummed. And then lo and behold, Alexander Ovechkin doesn't get any points in that game. Yeah. Goes the rest of the week and the first half of this week with no points. Do you think because he's so close, he might just be gripping the stick a little too tight and just you're that close?
Here's the thing. Alexander Ovechkin, if he's proven to us anything, he's an exceptional athlete.
Yes.
But he demonstrates to us, I think, in this moment that he is somewhat mortal at the same time. Because I think there is something to that. Even Alex Ovechkin can suffer from whether it's a distraction, whether it's a dip in confidence, whether it's just pure frustration, and there are broader team-related things that are affecting his play, the longer that goes, I think the more problematic it becomes for him and the team. It'll be a huge emotional release, I think, once he just notches 700 and he
for
and
the team
group,
too.
He and the group.
Did you know
just
the whole team's thinking
it.
About it too,
oh,
right? And
well,
his
listen.
Teammates, just not even consciously, like subconsciously, are probably passing him the puck more. They're probably looking for him more than they do on any given night, just because subconsciously, I think it's just human nature. You know, he's so close. You want him to get there, but it'll be good for the team as a whole, I think, when it's over and done with, to be honest.
And the way that looks for the team, for folks that may not have, you know, kind of caught the point or appreciated the circumstance, you know, the Washington Capitals are a pretty big deal in an average year. They're only 2 years removed from their Stanley Cup championship. And this is a club that draws a lot of attention, garners a lot of attention anyways, but their success this year, more attention. Alex Ovechkin approaching 700 and knocking some of the legends off of the platform, that gains more attention. So the point I'm making is there are loads and loads of microphones. There are microphones that come from outlets now that we don't normally see cover hockey now following this team. And it has to become a distraction over time. And I think that when this club is able to kind of, you know, Alex is able to kind of satisfy or register that goal and kind of move past it, it gets to be business as usual, which is exactly what these players want, given the time of year it is. Remember, this isn't, you know, we're not talking about October, November distraction. We're now approaching March, and it's time to button things down for, you know, for the big dance, the Stanley Cup playoffs.
The Capitals struggling a little bit, no longer in first place in the Metro Division. That belongs to the Pittsburgh Penguins. First time since 2019, I believe, that the Caps have not been in first place in the Metropolitan Division. And for Alex Ovechkin, it's a 5-game pointless drought, the longest this season. Ovi. Caps back in action tomorrow. We'll all be watching on the edge of our seats once again to see if he can hit 700 this week and make NHL history. Not a matter of if, though, just a matter of when.
Yeah.
Although I saw a really great tweet the other day, and it was future headline, Alexander Ovechkin chases 700 tonight against the Seattle Kraken. And I thought that was really, that was like a very good joke on Twitter. So whoever put that out there first, kudos to you, because that is a very funny over-exaggeration. But you know what? Not the only historic topic for today's pod. Obviously, for the last month or so, we've been celebrating the 40th anniversary of the Miracle on Ice.
Yes,
Tony Luffman, our resident Team USA super fan.
Do you think?
It's excessive.
I agree. He's a little bit.
But he's going to Vegas.
He's above average interest.
So the players that are going to be there are going to have to deal with Tony Luffman, which is never a bad thing, of course. I say that in jest. But for us, you know, on NHL Network, we've been playing the movie Miracle. And joining us today on the podcast is Patrick Demsey, who played Mike Ruzioni in the film. So, Patrick, we're excited to have you on the show. Thanks for doing this. How you doing, and where are you calling from?
I'm doing great. I'm calling from L.A. at Fox Studios.
Oh, nice,
Patrick, what are you up to what are we up to these days post Miracle on Ice? What can you tell our listeners about what you've been doing since the movie?
Well, I've been in L.A. since 2004, and I work as an actor still when it comes up, but I also do sculptures for film and TV. Oh. So whatever they need done, I don't know if you guys watched the Super Bowl, but there was a Walmart commercial with all these alien characters, and Flash Gordon flies in on his jet ski.
Yeah.
I made the jet ski.
Oh, wow. Whoa. That's fabulous.
So, yeah, you never know. They're going to call you and say, we need you to make something. And you say, what is it? And then you just
All I wanted to do when you said that was hit like a soundboard button, like, da, 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 da. Like, maybe we can put it in post. But that's so cool.
That's really cool. So do a lot of your pieces end up as part of movie sets? Or are you kind of, do you sell to more mainstream folks like Jack and I at the same time?
You know what's funny is I don't ever do any private art. I just do it for money when someone calls and needs something for a commercial or TV. It's funny because people will say, oh, let me see your artwork. Let me see. I said, unless you're paying, I'm not doing anything.
Oh, my gosh. I love it. Well, are you?
It's pretty fun, though.
Great.
It's so cool. And your story is so interesting. I talked to you a couple of weeks ago, but for our listeners right now that maybe haven't heard it, kind of just give us the background of how you got involved in the film, because your timing was perfect. You wanted to get into acting and you were a guy that, you know, was playing hockey, and the makers of this film were looking for hockey players that wanted to sort of try acting out. Go figure.
Yeah, that's correct. You know, I was doing an internship in graphic design to finish up college, and it was October of 2002. And yeah, like you said, I just decided, you know, maybe I had a thought, maybe I'll go to acting school. And I went on the internet to look for acting schools. And what I found that day was an open casting call for hockey players that could act or who wanted to try to act. And within 24 hours, I was in my first audition in Boston.
Oh, wow. What a great opportunity.
And it was.
To that point, kind of to what level of hockey had you kind of graduated? How high a level had you played to that point?
Well, let's just say I was a good, great locker room guy on a G3.
Hey, listen.
You're
speaking my language now. You're talking to a guy that was good in the room. In fact, about all he was good in the room.
that basically sums up my career. Good in the room.
So if you take yourself back to your first day on set, like what was the first scene that you filmed? And just take us through sort of that experience and that day. Do you remember the first scene that you filmed?
Yeah, so the first scene was actually when there's four of us that confront Herb Brooks outside of the bus. He's brought in another player, Tim Harrer, to sort of, ruffle everyone's feathers and get us worked up a bit. And so the first scene we ever shot was us confronting Herb Brooks in front of the bus. So we had met Kurt briefly, but I know the director and the producers wanted to keep like an air of mystery about him, keep him away from us a bit, because when we did that, you know, there was a lot of pressure on that for us to be intimidated by him.
Right.
And so, yeah, when he came out, I mean, he was just guns a-blazing in that scene. And it was really fun for us because we had been rehearsing for a month, you know. And there were times where I was rehearsing going, I don't think I'm very good at this, you know. And then, you know, Kurt came out and in character, and he was just magic and the only way I would explain it to people is he just sucked me into his world.
Yeah.
I knew my lines. I knew what I felt about it. But when he came out, it was all of a sudden, we're on set and it was real.
I always find it fascinating, too, that, in movies, you don't film the movie in chronological order. So to start with an emotional scene had to be difficult.
And it's a pivotal scene in the movie, too. There's a lot that kind of shifts in that moment. It's an interesting place to start. I'm with you, Jackie. I really am.
Yeah, it was pretty cool, and we flew into Rosslyn, British Columbia, because we shot the whole movie in Vancouver and D.C. So we flew into Rosslyn, which is a little ski town, and we were shooting there. And I remember we shot all night long, and it was freezing, right? We're out in the cold all night long, and about 4 o'clock in the morning, Kurt looks at us, and this is our first night ever making a movie, and he says, well, boys, Hollywood ain't all cocaine and sunglasses.
What a line!
That's perfect.
I know. It was just perfect. Absolutely perfect. Yeah.
Yeah. Talk a little bit. Of course, you know, but especially by this stage in his career, I mean, Kurt is a lifetime and A-list actor, well-established in the industry. What kind of rapport do you guys develop with the most noticeable figure as part of that cast?
Well, you know, like I said, they sort of kept a little distance between us and Kurt at the beginning. And I think it was, you know, this is just what my opinion was, is that they wanted to know that we, you know, once we knew the difference between Kurt and Herb, the character of Herb, then we got to spend a little more time with Kurt. And once they knew, okay, we could turn it on or turn it off on set, knowing what we had to do, then, you know, he opened up to us a lot more and we got to spend time with him.
Patrick, one other aspect of the movie that I, as a former player, really found interesting was just this whole set of friction between the guys from Minnesota, the guys from Boston. I thought you guys really carried that off well. Growing up in Danvers, Mass., does that kind of inform that whole dynamic for you? Do you have a sense of that going into this movie, and do you draw from that?
Yeah, I mean, there was from the beginning, the whole thing was a competition. I mean, you know, I went to a huge cattle call audition in Boston. You know, I auditioned there several times, and then they eventually, 2 months later, they had a camp in Los Angeles. So they brought a bunch of hockey players out to Los Angeles, and then they had a bunch of actors who were there. And so, I mean, it was like we were trying out, you know. So we were all competing against each other from the beginning. it was very much like the story of the Miracle on Ice, you know. And then we all came together as a team. They sent us all to Vancouver, and from there we began to gel as a team, and you know, and as a bunch of people who were acting.
Let me ask you about your relationship with Mike Ruzioni during this time. I mean, the player that you played in the film. What was your relationship like at the time of filming, and what kind of advice did he give you? What were your early conversations with him like in terms of how maybe he wanted you to present him and how the makers of the film wanted you to present him?
Well, what was funny about this is that I wasn't an actor. So, you know, now that I've learned the craft of acting, I would understand how to go into this situation, you know, a little better. Whereas then I had no idea. So, really what the director said to me, he said, "You have everything I need for Mike Ruzioni. There's a reason why I selected you. So you just have to be comfortable being yourself. And in being yourself, you will embody what Mike Ruzioni was," which was pretty comforting to me. It sort of took the pressure off. So when I met with Mike, I just wanted to be around him and to see how he dealt with people, how he spoke, you know, how he handled himself. And it was pretty funny because, the quote that you guys had last week on the show about him being a better hockey player than me.
Right.
The other part of that is that he said, "Yeah, Patrick's better looking than me, but I was a better hockey player."
Balance.
I said, "That's a good trade, Mike. We could do that."
I love that. So everyone from the team is in Vegas this week for a big celebration. I assume you're going to Vegas?
No, I'm not going to be there.
You're not going to Vegas?
No.
Oh.
You know, these things, these are a celebration of the Miracle on Ice. It's really not about the film. And, you know, I look at it, I'm just so fortunate to have been a part of it, because there's a whole generation now that sees me as Mike Ruzioni.
It's
really kind of weird, and it must be weird for him too, because I've started to see now, there's, you know, the movie came out 16 years ago, so there's a whole generation of people who have watched the movie that now have children that are sharing it with their children. So we're seeing a whole second wave of fans that love the movie.
And I'll say this too, like, hockey fans are so dedicated, so loyal. They're a very passionate fan base, hockey fans.
Absolutely. and we see the community come together in times of need, you know, like when there's tragedies within the hockey community, you really get to see, you know, they come together in good times and in bad times, which is really special about it.
Yeah. You know, just given your background in the game leading up to the actual production of Miracle, Patrick, how important is that moment, that Miracle on Ice moment that we all, you know, witnessed in amazement. How impactful is that on you as you kind of step into, you know, you become one of the cast at this point? Are you a little bit intimidated insofar as, you know, how do I effectively, you know, in a meaningful way, kind of communicate such an epic, epic moment, never mind sport, but in life?
Yeah, well, it is funny that we spoke with the director at length about this, Gavin O'Connor, because he said, you know, I think if we thought about it in that way of how do I translate how big this was,
yeah,
it's overwhelming. You can't. But I think as athletes, we all understand winning, you know, and every win, you know, it's a win. You want to celebrate a win every time, but it's just a matter of really the outside of perspective of it looking in, which makes it grand.
Yeah.
You know, and you look at the Cold War, you look at how good the Russian team was, you look at the fact that they were the U.S. team was a bunch of amateurs, and that really sets the stage for, you know, an upset. But we all understand what winning is. So he said, I just need you guys to win. I need you guys to celebrate winning, and I think you've all won. And we said, yeah, we've won at certain levels. He said,
yeah.
Do you remember what that was like? And I said, yeah. And he said, that's what it is.
Yeah.
You know, so really what we needed to do was translate the love. We needed to translate the love of our team. You know, we needed to translate the love of the game and the love of our country, and we all had that.
You're dancing all around it, Patrick, so I have to ask the question. Do you have a favorite quote, a favorite line from the movie itself? And, you know, Jackie and I are never one to put you on the spot, but
yeah, right.
go ahead and roll it out there. Give us your best miracle quote.
You know, it's funny. I think for me, it was one that really we're stretching in a circle when Tim Harrer comes out. I don't think I've ever said this, and we were just having some private banter between our team, and they were, you know, rolling cameras, and Ralphie Cox says to me, who's Kenny Mitchell, who played Ralph Cox, who's one of my dearest friends in the world now. He's just an amazing human. He said, you know, Rizzo's going to be making some meatballs, boys. and I just replied, yeah, if you guys keep eating them, I'll keep making them. it's like the only thing really, I think, that wasn't scripted.
Is that right?
That's so cool that I did
that ended up in the movie. And it was just a really, like, it was a personal moment for us, you know, that was like really fun that I love.
Oh, that is so cool. Well,
fabulous.
I mean, listen, it is a movie that just brings people together. We've been airing it on NHL Network for the last couple of weeks,
yeah,
in celebration of the 40th anniversary. You are always so much fun to talk to. Thanks for doing the show. We appreciate the time, and enjoy the rest of your week.
Jackie, thank you again. Stu, great to chat with you.
My pleasure. Patrick, thank you so much for joining us. This has been fantastic.
All right, guys.
Patrick Demsey, he is always fantastic. And for anyone listening to the pod or watching us on YouTube, first off, thank you. Second, if you haven't seen Miracle, you should definitely watch it. It's a wonderful hockey movie.
Can I do one quickie little anecdote?
What?
When it first came out, I went with my son, who's an avid hockey fan. We got there late, and I never sit near the front.
Okay.
But every seat was taken because it was so popular when it first came out. So we're front row, like to the very outside. I mean, we watched, my neck was rocked right back in the seat. So what is an epic movie just made it seem so much larger than life the way,
yeah,
I saw it the first time with my son. And it's so well done. It's such a, it's an amazing story told in a great, great way.
Yeah,
it's
really good if you haven't seen it.
If you love hockey, you gotta see that movie.
Yeah, and if you're younger and you don't understand maybe the impact of the Miracle on Ice, it's a great way to kind of put everything into context a little bit.
And you can do that on NHL Network.
You can. We have been airing it.
Just about any day of the week.
This is true. All right, I asked our wonderful listeners and viewers on Twitter yesterday to send me some. This is our last show before the deadline. So ask them for their wish list for their team, what they're hoping to see. So we're going to get to some of those questions right now. I'm going to start with this one. I find interesting. It's from Chris Anderson, Twin Andy. So you're a twin. That's cool. Okay. The Flames need to sell. This team isn't built to contend and could have a very quick retool selling assets and going all in for Taylor Hall. What is your reaction to that?
That's interesting. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I would, if I am Brad Tree Living, I am inclined to give this team a little more, this cast of characters a little more runtime, because I really like the way that forward core is built. We're seeing a dip from them, and perhaps a change or two is required up front, but I don't know. I'm inclined to kind of give them a pass this year, not blow it all up, and I think there's better hockey ahead for these Calgary Flames. I really do. I like that group really through every sector of the roster.
All right, fair enough. Next question from Mike Gaudette. I hope I'm saying that right. Avs fan here, given the recent injuries combined with the going rate for any help this deadline, unless the deal is absolutely right, I wouldn't sacrifice the growing future of this team. So that's Mike's thoughts. But yeah, when you look at the injuries, I mean, they're starting to pile up. Philip Grubauer out, Mikko Rantanen out, Nazem Kadri out, Matt Calvert out. The deadline is 5 days away. Do you think the Avs need to do something?
Heavy price to pay. Well, and look at the people you're attempting, the impact, the contribution you're attempting to replace, the Rantanen, the Kadri. You know, you're looking at a fairly, you're looking at a top six forward potentially to address that kind of subtraction from your roster. Does that leave you somebody like, leave you thinking Kreider at the end of the day? That's probably a pretty heavy price to pay for somebody that's built the way the Avs are right now. I think you're going to have Rantanen back certainly before the playoffs roll around. I'm not sure of Kadri's status, if he's that far out either.
Yeah, I think he's out. Like, he's on the IR,
Yeah.
He's not day-to-day,
so
tell you
that.
So,
I don't know. But goaltending for me is the one area that I'd be quicker to address that problem. And I know that with contracts expiring where Corey Crawford's concerned, although there is a no-trade situation attached to his deal, and
what about like a Georgiev?
Leonard, or perhaps grabbing a goaltender out of the New York threesome, the Rangers threesome, might be a possibility as well. But that is the one area for the Avs I could see going out and addressing a goaltending issue.
Yeah, because as good as Francouz has played, if that injury to Grubauer is a substantial one, which it's sounding like it is, and the good thing for the Avs and for Sakic is that they have the next few days to figure that out before the deadline's here. But I guess what I'm trying to say is, as well as Francouz has played, if you get to the postseason and you only have Francouz, that's not a good spot to be in. So I think Georgiev would be a nice like stopgap type goaltender to bring in if that is the case.
Or that
may
be a long-term fit. Georgiev may be a long-term fit, depending on how that works
out. I think they like Grubauer there as the number one.
Yeah.
But I guess, I mean, the clock's ticking, so the Avs have a lot of decisions to make in the coming days. All right, let's move on to another question. Bruin for life, so a Bruins fan here. Boston get Kreider for Heinen, Clifton, a second, and a Backes salary dump.
Ooh.
Let's just focus on the Kreider aspect of this proposed deal. Do you think Kreider would fit well with Boston? I mean, it fit well with any team, but
I think so, and it leaves you feeling, you know, like Boston's a little more dangerous than they were before they acquired Kreider. So I can see that certainly being a fit. That's a that's a pretty hefty price to pay if that ends up being the conceivable deal where Boston and the Rangers are concerned. So I don't know that Sweeney's falling all over himself to jettison all those assets for a Kreider at the end of the day.
But what about just acquiring Kreider? Like, forget about that specific deal from our listener. In terms of Boston going after a Kreider, do they need to do something of that nature?
In terms of a player transaction, I don't see that as a desperate situation. I realize that Boston's not playing the best hockey of the year, but that to me is a group that they've got a leadership core that I think is really going to see them through all that. They're really deep up front. Kreider would be a great fit. Obviously, he's got to slot in the top six somewhere, I think, at the end of the day. But, you know, I could see that being a nice ad without question.
Again,
if I'm Sweeney, I'm probably not falling all over myself to do it.
Yeah, okay, one more. Drew says, I'd love, all caps, I'd love to see my Maple Leafs pick up Ryan Reeves for a tougher lineup, as well as Matt Dumba. Let's start with the Ryan Reeves part of that, Drew. Thank you for tweeting into the show. I don't think... Vegas has any intention of sending Ryan Reeves anywhere.
I think Vegas likes what they've got in Ryan Reeves. I think that's a nice fit. Ryan Reeves plays, I don't know if they, I would, it'd be fair to say they roll four lines, but that fourth line gets a good bit of ice where the Vegas Knights
and
are concerned.
And he is their jam, right? Like, he brings jam into their lineup a little bit.
A lot of it.
Do you buy into the theory that the Leafs are quote-unquote soft?
Yes. But remember, we've been down this route with the Leafs before. If you go back three seasons in time, mm-hmm. Matt Martin was a Toronto Maple
yep.
Leaf. So we've kind of been down that road. I don't know if attempting that all over again with somebody like Ryan Reeves is necessarily the add they need. I think the element they lack, especially up front, and they could do with this on the blue line as well, Nazem Kadri did have his shortcomings without question, but he provided a good bit of bite where that lineup is concerned. Some bite in the forward core, some bite in the D core, and I
think good job shutting down the opposition as well.
Right, and I think you're in a much better, exactly right. I think he was very effective in that second line, third line center role, depending on the moment in time. So I think that would, to me, if I'm Dubas, that's where I'm looking. I'm looking to make a change across a broader spectrum of the roster rather than bringing in somebody like a Reeves. Although I think Reeves at the end of the day perhaps might command more in time on ice than somebody like a Martin did in the past. Hard to say how that would work out, but again, I like it across a broader range of the roster.
All right, well, we got a ton of responses to this tweet, so thank you to the 120 plus of you that sent in your trade wish lists. Unfortunately, we don't have time for all of them, but we appreciate the ones that you did send in as the deadline gets closer. Our next show will be post-trade deadline, where we can break everything down. So before I say goodbye, I want a prediction from you. Deadline day, do we see over or under 9 deals?
Just nine. Individual deals. You know,
I just picked that number randomly, by the way.
Yeah, that is an interesting, why 9?
I don't know. I feel like there's been
random,
a lot of
really
stuff happening the last few days. So.
Yeah, that leaves me thinking we should shake out less than 9 on deadline day
mm-hmm.
because there's bound to be.
But there's
going to
be those weird
so
little
I'm
ones
yes.
where like an AHL
so
team.
That's
you know,
so
you're
true.
Trading players that are on the farm teams and stuff.
I'm saying less than 9 deals.
Less than nine
deals. Given the activity to this point, assuming that
yeah.
continues up to the deadline, should be less than 9 deals.
I'm going to say it will be 9 deals. Am I allowed to pick 9? Just on
hey,
the spot?
It's
just
your
for fun.
It's your
it's
contest.
It's my game. I
it's
guess
your
I
contest. Pick whatever you like. Do whatever
All right,
you
fair.
Like.
Are you back next week?
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
2 in a row. Sweet.
Yeah, I think I'm doing the podcast with you.
I think you
week.
Are.
Yeah.
I think you're back
let's,
next week.
Let's do it in something other than black.
Yeah, we'll bring
week.
A little color
let's
into
try
the
and
fold.
Mix it up. Maybe some florals from you, and I'll, I don't know.
I'll work
I'll
on
do
it.
Do a velvet smoking jacket
I was
or something.
Gonna, I was hoping to maybe rock a backwards ball cap next week.
Oh, yeah.
We'll see. We'll see how it goes. But in the meantime, thank you for listening. Thank you for watching on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts or video content. We appreciate the time. Send us your comments on Twitter using the hashtag PuckCulture, and we will see you post-deadline. Good luck seeing some of your wishes come true on trade deadline day. We wish you the best. Have a great week, and we'll see you later.